Hi everyone, it's James here. Welcome to another video and Merry Christmas to you. Got the tree here with me and the tree over there too. Trying to be festive, got the jumper. I'm going to do a walk down memory lane style video today. Going to talk to you or tell you the story of how I came to discover Paul McCartney back in the mists of time. I have touched on this on the Beatle James channel once or twice, but I've never told the full blown story. So I thought I would do that. When I was a kid, when I was in reception, which in the UK is what we call the first year of being in school, I had a great teacher called Mrs. Catamole. Caroline Catamole was her name. She was a great big tall gangling lady, and she wasn't our main teacher, if her memory serves. She used to come and teach us every now and then, but she had a guitar. She had an acoustic guitar and I'd never seen one before. She'd bring it into class and she'd sing us songs on this guitar, and this used to just absolutely thrill me. It's quite funny because I don't think any of the other kids in my class were particularly interested in this guitar. In fact, I got the impression that a fair few of them used to dread her bringing it out, you know, but I just used to absolutely love it. I mean, my dad was a pianist and we had a piano in our house, and from a very early age I listened to piano music. There was a lot of piano music around in our house. Classical piano mainly. So the guitar was something different. It was a totally different instrument. It was tactile, you know, you held it. It was just, there was something just utterly amazing about it. I used to ask her, I used to say, you know, are you going to bring your guitar in tomorrow? And she'd say, you know, maybe. And I'd be like, oh yeah. And I've got one memory one day of just, there was a curtain in the classroom and I pulled it back and Mrs. Catamole's guitar was just lying on this table out of its case, and it was the first time I'd seen it really up close, and I remember touching it and feeling it and going, oh wow, you know, amazing. And I was given a little guitar for Christmas, just a kind of toy guitar. I never learned to play it, but I used to bash away at it and you know, do my best with it. And so I was really into guitars, so kind of fast forward maybe 2 or 3 years, we get to 1977. I wasn't really interested, I wasn't really aware of the pop charts, the music charts. It got to Christmas or autumn of 1977. I remember being at my grandparents' house, and it was at 202 Brim Place in Clyne, near Wrexham. I'll show you the house on the screen. So this is the very house where I first clapped eyes on Paul McCartney. My parents used to go into town to do their Saturday morning shopping, and they used to drop me off at my grandparents' house, and it was a little red brick council house with a coal fire, and I would sit by the fire eating Jemmy Dodgers and you know, just watching TV. My granddad would normally be watching sport on a Saturday. He watched Grandstand, which is a kind of all day long sports programme. But for some reason, on this particular Saturday, it wasn't tuned to the sport, it was tuned to something else. It might have been that they put Swap Shop on for me, which was a very well-known and very popular children's TV show back in the 1970s. And I was just kind of sat in the living room watching this thing, and all of a sudden, it just cut to this kind of outdoor scene with this guitar music playing, and there was a guy sat on a gate or a fence with long hair, with his wellies on, playing a guitar, singing this song, and it was in Mull of Kintyre. And I'd never seen Paul McCartney before. I didn't know anything about him. I didn't recognise him. But the first thing I clocked was the length of his hair. I just thought, wow, this guy's hair is really long. You know, you don't see men with hair this long. Not sure why, because we were well into the 1970s by this point, so men did wear their hair long. But my dad always had a crew cut. You know, I mean, perhaps in North Wales we didn't have long hair with men, I don't know. But anyway, long hair, but this guitar was the main thing. He had this guitar, and it was a very guitar-driven song. And then the bagpipes came in, and the whole thing, you know, walking along the beach. It was just a kind of confluence of things, really. And I'd always loved Scotland. I had some cousins in Scotland, just to move the tree out of the way. So, you know, love guitars, loved Scotland, loved this guy's long hair. I loved his voice as well. We went out. Okay, so my parents came back from town, and I've got such a strong memory of running into the kitchen as they came in through the back door saying, I've just seen this great song. It was a man in Scotland singing this song with a guitar and all these bagpipes. And I think my mum did know who this was, because my mum was always, she always had a kind of knowledge of what was going on in popular culture, because she was a school teacher. I think she knew, and she was like, oh yeah, that's Paul McCartney. Now, neither of them told me who Paul McCartney was at this point, but they kind of identified him for me. And a couple of days later, we went into town, and we bought the 45 of Mull of Kintyre. This is not it. This is a recent German copy of Wings' Greatest Hits that I bought. But it's got the famous photo of the Mull of Kintyre 45 picture on it. And I just played this record to death. It was just such a pivotal moment, really. Paul McCartney was the first pop star I totally kind of homed in on, just as a person. And very soon after this, I started dressing like him, or I tried to grow my hair a bit long, a bit like him, although I was never actually allowed to grow it as long as Paul McCartney had it. But I remember I used to try and grow it down at the back a little bit, so it used to curl down here a little bit, because that's what his did. If you look at the picture, it's that classic 1970s mullet with the hair resting on the shoulder. I used to try and get my hair as far as I could down onto my shoulder before I was dragged down to the barbers and had it chopped off. But my parents, or my dad, took some photos of me in the back garden pretending to be Mull of Kintyre, Paul McCartney, in my wellies with my guitar. And we saw there was a magazine article with Paul McCartney pulling all these funny faces. I think it was the same photo shoot that had produced the back cover of Wings at the Speed of Sound. And there are some photos of me doing the faces of Paul McCartney from that back cover. I totally identified with him. That's the only way I can sort of describe it. And from that moment on, I was absolutely smitten. My dad's boss lent his band On the Run, and which I just totally loved. And that album was a kind of magical doorway, really. It's got a very magical sound to it. There's a certain atmosphere to that record. I think for a child, it's a very interesting album. It's kind of like songs within songs. It's like a little kind of Aladdin's Cave of Wonders, really. Very imaginative lyrics, and I was really, really drawn to it. But then, you know, my dad then, he just sort of magically produced this record one day. He magically produced his copy of Revolver, which he'd had on vinyl for, I think he'd bought it in about 1970 as a gift for my mum. And he produced it one day. I'd never seen it before, because he didn't keep it with his main records, because my dad's a classical music fan. His records that he played were all in the living room in this case, but he had a handful of records that he didn't really play in the other room, and he brought this record out, and it was Revolver, and he said, this is the, you know, this is the man from the Mull of Kintyre thing. And I remember looking at it and trying to piece that together in my head, because, you know, it was kind of like doing a piece of detective work, really. And then I heard Revolver and all the songs by McCartney on there, and you know, that was another level. It was like a kind of hatch door opening, or a kind of wormhole in the fabric of time and space, and I just fell straight through it into the world of Revolver. And I think part of it was, actually, we'd moved house in 1976, in the summer of 76. I was only 5 years old, and you know, I think I spent about a year not really having any friends, because I was still going to school in the village where we'd lived before. It was about 12 months before I was settled in at the new school, so I didn't really have that many friends in the village for quite a long time. And I think Paul McCartney and the Beatles and Wings, they sort of became my surrogate family, really. I think I drew a lot of emotional comfort from that. And my grandmother and I, we started making a scrapbook. She used to buy magazines and newspapers, and anytime she found a picture of McCartney or anything, she would send it to me, or I'd see her, and we'd cut it out and we'd stick it in this scrapbook. Hopefully I can cut in some film clip of the scrapbook, because I still have it. It's in a right old mess now. It was kind of Paul McCartney all down the line, really. I didn't really become aware of the other Beatles properly until John Lennon was murdered in 1980. London Town was the first Wings album that I owned myself. Got that in 1978. And this record was not really in the same league as Band on the Run, but it's got a very warm, nostalgic sound to it. It's the sound of childhood to me, really, you know, and the blue sky and everything. And I've got very clear memories of listening to this. In my lunch hour, I used to come home from school for my lunch and listen to records and then go back to school again, because, you know, the school was only 2 minutes walk down the road. There's one last memory I want to share with you, and that's When Paul was arrested during the Japan bust, I remember actually being in tears in my bedroom looking at this picture, because I read somewhere that there was a chance that Paul was going to go to prison for a long time and wouldn't be able to write any more music for a long time. And I do remember being very, very worried and very, very upset. It was almost like a family member was, you know, in trouble. And I think I would have been about, have a look, I'd have been 7 years old at this point, 1978, and it did seem like Paul was sort of my other dad, really. Paul and Linda, in fact, I kind of thought of them as being my other mum and dad. I had a poster of them on my wall. It was a poster from the London Town album. I had that on my bedroom wall, and they were sort of, you know, Paul and Linda were my other mum and dad, and I had my uncle Denny Lane kind of thing. He was my uncle. They were just another family for me, I think. And that kind of bedded down, I think, my whole interest in music and everything that came after. I used to tune in to watch Top of the Pops in January of 1978 in order to see Mull of Kintyre, but it dropped out of the charts, of course, not that long into 1978. It was knocked off by Anthea and Donna doing Uptown Ranking, and I was absolutely shocked and horrified, you know, to tune into Top of the Pops expecting to see Paul, Linda and Denny on the Mull, and you got these two girls doing this reggae song. It was just absolutely traumatic for me. But by that point I was hooked into watching Top of the Pops by then. And so in 1978, a lot of things came thick and fast. You know, you had things like, you know, Grease came out, and then I discovered the Motors, and there was the Boomtown Rats, and then there was Squeeze, which was a really big one for me. Squeeze was the next big explosion, really, I think, for me. But nothing will ever replace that initial thrill of Paul McCartney. He was the absolute genesis of it all, I suppose. So, anyway. Thought I'd share that with you, and you know, to me, Paul McCartney always was the gift that kept on giving, and here we are, it's Christmas time, a time for giving and sharing. So, hope you enjoyed the video. Take care, folks. See you soon. Bye bye.